Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our Voices from Florida event. We'll be starting in just a few minutes. And before we begin with our presentation today, I do have some information just about this event series and about our department. So Voices from Florida is an event series put on and presented by the Special Collections Department at the Miami-Dade Public Library System. This is an event series that's dedicated to telling stories about Florida's history, culture, and community. Today, we have a fantastic presentation titled Documenting the History of Black Miami that will be given by filmmakers Anne-Marie Henry, Christine Malcolm, and Keith Moore. The Special Collections Department houses unique materials about Florida, genealogy, local artists, and more. So if you haven't ever visited us in person, we are located at the main downtown branch of the library on the second floor. I really encourage everybody to stop by and visit because we have a lot of materials that are available only at this branch. For today's presentation, I wanted to introduce our speakers, Anne-Marie Henry, Christine Malcolm, and Keith Moore. Had their paths crossed at work, where their common passion and interest to preserve Miami's history led to the development of the documentary series, The History of Black Miami. The History of Black Miami aims to tell the story of the people of the African diaspora who built Miami from the mid-19th century to the present day in a series of documentaries. It is through this work that the descendants of one Miami pioneer, Alexander C. Lightborn, was found and honored by both the City of Miami and the Greater Bethel AME Church in early 2021. And we'll be hearing more about that during the presentation. So I'm going to turn it over to our first speaker, Keith Moore, and he will begin our presentation today.
Greetings. My name is Keith Moore. I, along with my colleagues, Christine Malcolm and Anne-Marie Henry, would like to thank the Miami-Dade Public Library System Special Collections Department for this opportunity to share in the history of the descendants of Afro-Caribbean and African-Americans and their contributions to the founding of the city of Miami. When I was a little boy, I would ride around with my grandparents in my grandfather's truck. If you rode around, there seemed to be no neighborhood they didn't remember from what I used to call the olden days. In 1918, my grandfather came to Miami, to Coconut Grove, to America, looking for a better way of life. Upon his arrival, he found work and earned enough money to return to Bluff Cat Island in the Bahamas to marry and bring my grandmother back to Coconut Grove. They would often talk about how in the early days, people helped each other as they started to settle in a new way of life in Coconut Grove. Little did I realize at the time the seed that was being planted in me. But there seemed to be thousands of stories over the years. And by the 1970s, I was still riding around with my grandparents, but now I was driving them. Once I took them on I-95 and then we passed down by downtown Miami, my grandmother looked out the window and said, no one could have ever told her that Miami would turn into the city that it was looking back at the times when she first arrived there. This was the day that I realized that my grandparents were pioneers. And that's what inspired me to embark upon this project with Christine and Anne-Marie. When oftentimes in the telling of history, the achievements of so many that had a positive effect on history had been left out in the telling of historical events. An example: who is the only woman in the history of the United States to be a founder in a major American city? It was Julia Tuttle. Julia Tuttle convinced Henry Flagler to extend his lines, his rail lines to South Florida beyond West Palm Beach. It was Julia Tuttle who donated the land that the foundation of the city of Miami was built upon. Now, Henry Flagler was the developer, but Julia Tuttle was the founder, a fact not so pronounced in the historic tellings of a Miami dating back to 1896. Coconut Grove was a community long before the collaboration of Julia Tuttle and Henry Flagler. and it was established in 1873. Now, the Homestead Act of 1862 granted 160 acres of government survey land to any citizen or future citizen of the United States, provided that the grantee lived on the land for 5 years, built the dwelling, planted crops, and improved the land. If grantees fulfilled this criteria, they would be granted deeds to said lands. Now, there was three such deeds granted to the Pent family, the Beasley family, and the Froh family that would incorporate Coconut Grove. The Pent homestead was on east of Grand Avenue and was deeded in 1895. The Beasley homestead was west of Grand Avenue, deeded in 1878, and the Froh homestead was west of the Beasley homestead, separated by Main Highway, deeded in 1892. It would be on the Froh homestead where the first free blacks from the Bahamas would settle, and what would be called Kibo, Color Town, Evangelist Street, West Coconut Groves, Plymouth Rock. It was the coming together of Charles Peacock, British born Charles Peacock, and Mariah Brown that would set in motion the establishment of Coconut Groves Color Town, a community that would last for more than 100 years.
Miami's Coconut Grove, with its luxury hotels, lavish lifestyles, exclusive restaurants, and its famous sidewalk cafes. A thriving, vivacious suburb of Miami, Florida. Here in Coconut Grove is a community that was established before Miami became a city by a pioneering breed of settlers that rose to the challenge of creating a settlement in South Florida that attracted tourists from the Northeast to this oasis on the bay. British-born Charles Peacock built the Bayview Hotel to accommodate the floods of tourists now coming from the northeastern United States to Coconut Grove. When Peacock needed laborers to facilitate in the operations of his Coconut Grove Inn, he went to Key West looking for that person to help him run his Coconut Grove Hotel. The one name that kept coming up was Mariah Brown, a washerwoman who migrated from the island of Eleuthera in the Bahamas to Key West. Mariah Brown would become a pioneer in the development of Miami, Florida, an American city.
They came coming for her in Key West. They needed somebody to work at the Peacock Inn. And everybody knew Mariah in the community there in Key West. Mariah Brown is the woman you should very happy to employ.
In Key West, Florida, she met the Peacocks, who asked her to come with them to Miami to start a residence inn.
I don't know Mr. Peacock to this day, but I'm very appreciative of him of giving my great-great-grandmother Mariah Brown a job, because I find out she was a very entrepreneur.
She was very well known and very well respected.
All kinds of people live in Key West, mostly Bahamians, colored and white, doing what they've been doing for hundreds of years, sponging, turtling, fishing, and wrecking. I find me a place to rent on Emma Street, where Eleutherans live close together and help one another. All I know is, by the time the Peacocks reached Key West, looking for somebody to help them work at a hotel in Coconut Grove. I have three little girls, Ella, Lula, and baby Alice. I tells the Peacock, I think on it. By morning, me and my girls were standing on the porch when the Peacocks come. They only two Negroes in Coconut Grove when me and my girls reach. Very soon, I fetch many more from Eleuthera, Nassau, Abaco, and Key West.
So then she brought others, you know, to come and build their homes. And so that's how the community developed.
And that's when she called other Bahamians to build houses, and that's how their neighborhood grew.
So Mariah Bryan was one of the first Bahamians, might have been the, one of the first two women that Charles Peacock brought to Coconut Grove. I interviewed people when I did my book who were in their 90s who knew Mariah Bryan when they were children. And they told me that she was a wonderful woman, that she was a person who a lot of people relied upon in that community. And I was told that she became ill with breast cancer and went back to the Bahamas for treatment because the doctors in Nassau in the Bahamas were better than the doctors here in early Miami. But everything I heard about her led me to believe that she was just an absolute bedrock member of this community.
Peacock in spreading. Lots of visitors coming down from the east.
He took a job at the Peacock Inn, which again was a big job provider because it was the only inn in the area. And as the inn prospered, they expanded it, and they also built this bathing pavilion down on the water close to where McFarland would dead end at the bay.
Oh, I beyond grateful to the Peacocks for bed and board. Every day I say, one day, Mariah, you going to build a house on your own. I saves every penny I can.
He saved her money. He did candy. He made candy, sold dinners, you know, throughout the neighborhood. He's one of the persons that today we need more of to look up to.
Lula say, you are dreaming, Mama. I decide to be a part of it all. Buys me a piece of land if and somebody sells me it. So I yucks up my courage and ask Miss Joseph Fro if and she'll sell me a piece of her land. She says yes. And she say I can pay 50 cents a week. You want to know something? I dream me this small house. It may be small, but it's mine.
Well, what we know with the documentation we have is that Mariah Bryan was the first documented Black Bahamian person to come. She came in 1889.
I said, that's my kind of woman, because I had found a woman that I could connect with. I could find a woman that was a role model for my life, and universally so. A woman who was a washerwoman, who washed clothes all day long and went home dog tired. This to me was what I like to call an uncommon common woman.
I think it's part of the problem is we don't tell the story and our young people, and I learned late in life about the story. So I think it's important that we tell the story, and if she could do what she did at that time, there's so much more that we can do with what we have.
As she came to the Grove, she bought the first house. And the first house was located on Charles Avenue, and it still stands today.
She was the only Black woman that built a house, the first house in Miami in Coconut Grove area.
They started the St. Paul's AME Church in Mariah Bryan's house. That's very early.
Child, if it be the same way 100 years from now, Coconut Grove, a fine place to live.
Coconut Grove was a unique community unto itself in 1896, by the time the city of Miami was incorporated. There within Coconut Grove's existence was a semi-integrated community, as the concept of Jim Crow laws of separate but equal were made equal and beginning to take root in America. The lifestyles in Coconut Grove were uncommon in this aspect of American racial relationships, especially in the South.
On May 18, 1896, the landmark decision in the Plessy v. Ferguson case, which upheld the constitutionality of segregation, was passed into law.
When I came back from the First World War, Miami was growing up with all kinds of people. The people had such different backgrounds. The Ku Klux Klan were doing dreadful things. My father was driving when a masked Ku Klux Klansman on a horse told him he couldn't pass. They were preparing for a march. My father shouted, "Get out of my way," and drove straight ahead, scattering them. How could you live with people like that? I like Coconut Grove. It is a community of people that had backgrounds other than that. I am quite sure there are no Ku Klux Klan in Coconut Grove. Marjorie Stoneman Douglas.
The real racists lived in the brand new city of Miami that started in 1896, the same time as Plessy versus Ferguson. And the Grove, you see, goes back to the 1880s. So there was an established community in Coconut Grove before there ever was a Miami. For the time, Coconut Grove was very inclusive because many of the people who moved there were sophisticated Northerners.
The onset of what we call Jim Crow segregation, I mean, they reached out to the black community, especially children, as well as the white community children. And they had, like, you know, a reading session for them some Sundays and made ice cream for them. And they're partly responsible for the creation of the library and the Oddfellows Hall and Charles Avenue and the West Grove. And
so when we think of Coconut Grove, you got to think of it's Mommy's First Community. You've got to think that it was made up of a bunch of very sophisticated settlers and a group of very talented Bahamian workers.
There is history in plain sight that is not acknowledged. There is history in plain sight that is not explored. And there is history in plain sight that is progressively being torn down. Just think about this. Most of us have only received a total of 13 months of Black history education in our primary and secondary schooling. That's 1 month for every year we are in school. Now, my formative education is right here in Miami-Dade County. And I can honestly tell you that I do not remember ever being educated on the history of Miami, Dade County, and South Florida. South Florida's history is vast, it's varied, and it's ever-changing, but it's mostly centered on the white settlers of the area, such as Julia Tuttle, Henry Flagler, and Mary Brickell. Now, how many people today can honestly say that they've ever heard of these names, Dan Anderson, Dr. Lula Reddick, and Dr. Dazelle Dean Simpson? Not many. This is exactly one of the reasons we decided to unmask these individuals. It's important for those of us who live in this community to understand not only the contributions of the notable pioneers, but also the change makers that were and are hidden in plain sight. So for my portion of this presentation, I want to focus on some of the resources that we used in the research process that helped us to uncover these untold stories. I also want everyone to know and to understand that we are all capable of conducting research. It just takes time, patience, and perseverance. The end goal is to find facts, verify them the best of your ability, and tell a story. Remember, we are researching real people. As community researchers, just know that finding out about history is not untouchable to anyone. Telling the story of the untold is always important for those of us living in the here and now. So as we go to the next slide, I'm going to show you just what we did in terms of our research. Now, you don't have to follow these direct steps, but this is just how we did it. So first thing first, you don't need to leave your home to start research. Research can start in your backyard, next door neighbors, down the street, local parks. We picked a subject. In our case, we picked three individuals, E.W.F. Stirrup, Dan Anderson, and Mariah Brown. And then what we did is we wrote down what we knew about them. We knew that they were born in Bahamas. They lived in Coconut Grove. They lived on Evangelist Street, now known as Charles Avenue. And two of the homes, E.W.F. Stirrup and Mariah Brown, are currently still in the same location that they were built in the 1800s. What we're going to do also is we wrote down what we wanted to say, what we wanted to tell. And for our part, we wanted to tell the story of the Black pioneers in Coconut Grove and South Florida. And remember, the internet, it is a useful tool. It's not just for playing games and for watching movies. You can use it to find information on any subject that you want. So as we go to this next slide, you'll take a look and see that these are the current photos of E.W.F. Stirrup's home and Mariah Brown. And so if you're in Coconut Grove and you want to take a look and say, hey, what do these homes look like that were built in the 1800s? Here you are. They're right there, and that's their address. So as we go to the next slide here, these are some of the areas that I think that some people, when you're looking for research, you don't know where to go, how to start, what to do. Local library is the best place to go because they have a lot of research information here. And the best person in terms of the library is Miami-Dade Public Library, which we're in right now. Broward County Library and the African American Research Library and Cultural Center. Those are the three that we use. But of course, there are so many more that you can go to. We also went to the Black Archives, which is a wealth of information in terms of Black history in South Florida. And some of the local colleges that we use, but again, you can use as many as you want. We use Florida International, University of Miami, Florida Memorial University, which is the only Black historical university and college in the southern area here in South Florida, and the University of Florida Online. And the museums that we went to was the History Miami, which is right around the corner from this local branch here, and Palm Beach County History Museum. And we went there because for some who may not know, Dade County actually extended all the way into Juno Beach. So some of the information, although we're looking for information in South Florida about what's happening in Coconut Grove, we have to remember that during that time, Dade County reached all the way there. So guess what? That's where our research had to extend all the way to the public Palm Beach County History Museum. So as we go on to the next slide, of course, we're in the library, so we have to talk about some of the resources that we use here. And the first person of contact and first people of contact are the librarians. If you come into the library and you don't know what to do, you don't know where to start, you don't know where to go, guess what? And this is in any branch. Start with the librarian right at the desk. Ask them, tell them what you're looking for and say, hey, I'm looking for this, I'm looking for that. And maybe they can point you in the direction. And if they don't have it at that particular library, more than likely it's going to be down here at this main library branch because they usually have most of the information here. And online, these are some of the resources that are online. We have Newsbank, which is the Miami Herald. So we're talking about Miami Herald from the 1920s until current issues and information you can get there, as well as they have an Ancestry Library edition. Now, it's not the full edition, so to speak, but you can get a lot of information if you're looking for birth certificate, death certificate, city directory, all of that is going to be on that library. And you need a library card. That's it. It's free. So it's not going to cost you anything other than getting yourself a library card, logging in, and then going to the that Ancestry Library collection as well. So if you're looking for like photos and other information, documents, mining corporation paper. They actually scanned it now because it used to be, it was on a book here when we came, it was not scanned at the moment, but during, you know, our 2-year sprint that we had here, they actually scanned that document into the digital collection. So you can see some of the signers that were on the incorporation. And for those who may not know, 162 of those signers were Black men. So that is integral to what we were doing. So we found that information there. Now, interlibrary loan, the vault, microfilm, and city directory, the actual city directories, you can come here to the main library. Because if you want to use the microfilm, you actually have to come to the main library because they're the only ones that have it. And the scholarly journals, you can actually get them online or you can see them, read them in person here as well, because they have a lot of information in terms of when you're doing research and you're reading through it, now you have to look at what the references are. Now, if you are a student or anyone for that matter, once you read something, you're like, well, where did they get that information from? That helped us a lot because sometimes we're reading through and you're reading about Mariah Brown or you're reading about the first Black school and you don't know where to go. If you go into the back, once you finish looking at the scholarly journal, look at the back part of it, you'll see that they have a reference. It tells you it was an 1892 newspaper, Miami Herald or whatever newspaper it is. It's that is going to help you a lot in your research journey, especially because we are researching people that, one, we cannot talk to them. Two, this is 125 plus years ago. So some of the information is kind of difficult for us to find. And so it's documented in newspaper articles in so many different ways. This is a great way to find it. Some of these scholarly journals are very, very, very helpful. So as we go into our next slide, these are some of the resources that will break down information, names, dates, when people are married. For instance, the census, the 1950 census actually just came out on April 1st. So for anyone who's doing research and you got stuck in the 1940 census, guess what? The 1950 census is open. So now you can take a look and continue your research on family records, photographs, family trees, Bibles. These are vital. Sometimes you have a photo and if you flip the back of the photo, you might find some information on a name. You see a picture, but you don't know who is that person. Flip over the photo, you might find a name. And that's what we found in some of our research. We found names, we found correct spellings of names because for us, because we were dealing with individuals from a different country, which is the Bahamas, and then they're Black individuals, sometimes they weren't so careful in documenting. So the name spellings of names weren't always consistent. Dates weren't always consistent. Birth dates, marriages, all of that information is documented in census. And if you track the census from like say 1940 to 1950, you can see sometimes people are considered mulatto, but then the next census, they're considered Black. So that takes all of that information. You really have to absorb it. And then how do you put that together to get that story? And as you see, we have vital records, which birth records and death certificates are just a few. So they're self-explanatory. Some of the newspapers that we use and National Archives, we got a lot of information from National Archives in terms of World War II records, any newspapers that we may not be able to get here. Sometimes they have it on the National Archives. Some books are on the National Archives as well. The United States Department of Interior, where we had the land paper that was shown in the previous presentation that Keith had, that's where we actually got the land paper. We have the actual, we don't have it with us today, but we actually went online and ordered them and we got, so we can see like, hey, who was Ulysses S. Grant signed the land paper at that time, because that is integral to reading everything. You have to read everything, break it down so that you see what's going on. Now, Florida Memory is the State Library and Archives of Florida. Again, just another wealth of resources that sometimes maybe you know you don't get here at this library, but they may have it there as well. So if we go to the next slide here, and then another section, which is organizational records, churches. Churches, sometimes we overlook churches, but believe it or not, they have a lot of information. There is so much information in a church, in a Bible. If someone dies, obviously, you know, you have the program from the cemetery, from the wake and so forth. All of that information helps you to break down and to understand. Maybe they had a sister you didn't know about. Maybe they were married, or maybe they weren't. You know, those are things that you find out from the churches, when they were born, when they died, when they were christened, baptism, if they were born in America or not. You would be surprised all of the information you find there. So these are some of the churches that we went to in Coconut Grove to get that information, as well as the cemetery. Now, we went there, obviously, to see if the people were buried there, and then also to take a look and see what's on the headstone, because believe it or not, you can find a lot of information just on the headstone, because sometimes the census may just give you a birth year. But when you find the headstone of the person that died, you may get the birth year, the actual full birth date and death, plus information. Maybe they were a father, a mother, they were a veteran. And in our research, we found a lot of information there, especially when you get to the city cemetery. You have some of the incorporators, their wives were buried with them, right? They tell you that they, you know, incorporators were there, and I believe there are 20 Black incorporators that are buried in the city cemetery. Well, we know at least two of their wives were buried there as well, and a daughter for one of them, a daughter was there. And some of the social clubs we used was the Women's Club of Coconut Grove. Now, while that was for white women, but some of the information that was documented really took forth the information that was going on. What was the social climate of the area? What was happening with not only the white individuals in Coconut Grove, but the Black individuals, and how they work together and how they work separately. So we found a lot of that information, luckily from, I'll show you in the next one, from Sandra Riley. She actually has an entire section at the archives in the University of Miami, and she really did a really, really awesome job on documenting that information. And as we head on over to some of the historians, some of the local historians that we interviewed, everyone that's on this page right here, some unfortunately have passed on, but Arva Parks McCabe, integral part in terms of her impact on writing about Coconut Grove and the Coral Gables area, and her thesis on Coconut Grove is something to read if you really want to get an in-depth information of what was happening and, you know, the people that she got a chance to interview that, unfortunately, you know, they've passed on since. But some of those things that she put in her thesis really just an eye-opener and helped us to navigate what we were going to do. Sandra Riley, she's a playwright, and she was in some of the videos that you've seen so far, and she wrote a play about Mariah Brown. There's some, you know, for me, doing the research specifically on Mariah Brown, when you're researching her, the spelling of her name is something even so small, but you see it here on the markers, they have her name spelled with an H. But for everything that I found during my research, there's no H. So why is there an H? Who put the H there? That's something small that we're still trying to find out. When did this H come in there? But that makes a big difference when you're looking for someone, because one letter can skew your research process, and then you're looking for someone and you can't find that person. Dr. Paul George is the preeminent, you know, historian at the History of Miami. So he's another person who's done not only just Coconut Grove, but this Miami as well. And that Dr. Marvin Dunn and Dr. Enid Pickney, awesome, awesome researchers. Dr. Marvin Dunn has a book called Black Miami. And if you want to read anything about Black Miami, I suggest you take that book, and it's in the library, or you can get it online or wherever. And Dr. Enid Pinckney is actually the person behind the saving of the Hampton House, as well as the Lemon City Cemetery. So a lot of people don't know about this cemetery, but, you know, when they were building, I don't know if it's a condo or something, but they found a lot of bones. And when they dug it up, they realized, wait a minute, there are a lot of, what's going on here? Come to find out, a lot of Black folks had lived there, like Bahamian folks had lived in the Lemon City area. And one of the people, once she started doing research and getting all the names to find out exactly when this cemetery was there and who did this and whatever, She found that her grandfather was one of the people buried in that cemetery. So now there is a marker out there that you can see all of the names of this cemetery that they almost built over with the hotel or apartment complex, but they didn't because she stopped it. And do not overlook your neighbors, right? Some of these, like Mrs. Gibson, Mrs. Leona Cooper, and Charles Bethel, some of these people, they are pioneers themselves. For instance, Mrs. Gibson, the first nurse to work on the surgical floor at Jackson Memorial Hospital. She's still alive, very much alive, still thriving, doing what she needs to do. Do not overlook your neighbors, because sometimes asking your neighbors information and questions will open up a door that you didn't even know about. So in closing here, I want to just take a look and say, look, as we stated, our initial goal was to just research three people in Coconut Grove. But with anything, sometimes you see a name that just sparks an interest. And while walking back from a lunch break with Keith at the Black Archives, we stopped in front of Bethel AME Church. And we saw this name on the building. And mind you, we'd seen this name a couple of times, specifically in Dr. Dunn's Black Miami book. And then we just happened to stop in front of the church. We're going to, you know, take a picture or whatever, and saw the name on the side of the wall. And I said, wait a minute, I know this name. And we had to research this person. And the name that we found, and he's integral in a lot of things in South Florida and in this incorporation of the city. His name was Alexander C. Lightborn.
Good afternoon. I remembered one day speaking with my colleague, Keith Moore, about Black Miami history, and he mentioned one of the Black incorporators, Alexander C. Lightborn. And in the course of the conversation, I Googled him and found him and found his headstone in the City of Miami Cemetery. And I noticed his list of accomplishments, and I thought, could this be true? Could a Black man accomplish this much in the latter part of the 19th century? He's listed as one of the African-American founder of our city. He served on the state executive committee. He was a sergeant of arms at Florida House of Representatives, a teacher and justice of the peace, a founder of Bethel AME Church. And I thought, is this really true? Could a Black man accomplish this much in a time that was so steeped in white supremacy? And I was intrigued. So I attached myself to find out more. Other internet searches, a few articles in the Miami Herald, a write-up in FIU Tequesta's publication noted that another early Miami pioneer, Isidore Cohen, credited a darkie named Lightborn that gave the best speech at the Miami Incorporation meeting. And I remembered my initial reaction when I first came across that statement, and I did not feel kindly towards Mr. Cohen. But I've since adjusted my feelings towards him. I'm now grateful to him because his statement told me a few things. There were Black people at the Miami Incorporation meeting. A Black man at that meeting gave the most eloquent speech. He admired A.C. Lightborn. They might have even been friends in early Miami. And he felt this information was important enough to mention after Lightborn's death in 1908, because Isidore Cohen made this statement at Miami's 15th birthday and Miami's 25th birthday. Now, in order to incorporate a city or a settlement into a city at the time, the state of Florida mandated that there had to be at least 300 registered voters in the areas. And there were more than 300 people settled here at the time, but some were women, and women were not allowed to vote, not even in a city founded by one. So 168 Black men were registered to vote to be able to sign the charter, which would incorporate the city of Miami. And this is a list of some of their signatures. You will see that they're listed as Black and white to the left or to the right of their name. And this is A.C. Lightbourne's signature. Lightbourne, A.C. The Miami-Dade Public Library System resources were extremely useful in finding out more about A.C. Lightbourne. More specifically, the library edition of Ancestry.com was crucial in this endeavor. The 1900 census information came quite easily, and subsequent directory information up to the early 1900s, but so much more was still missing. The 1900 census show him living here at Northwest 8th Street and First Place. This is a parking lot next to the Overtown rail station. The Lightbournes of Overtown slowly disappeared from Miami by death, by removal, and by migration. Harry Lightbourne, the youngest son of the family, died in 1957. And while migration from the Bahamas produced more Lightbournes in Miami, none of them knew anything about Lightbourne and his family. I spent hours and went through thousands of documents trying to locate Lightbourne's descendants. So I went back to the 1900 census to look for the people who were unaccounted for. And I followed the people who migrated from Miami, the grandsons, Edwin and Orrington. And through some twists and turns, I found the offspring of Orrington Lightbourne, his granddaughter, Allison Lightbourne Jones. And this is the story of how Lightbourne came full circle.
On July 28, 1896, 368 men met in a pool hall on Avenue D to incorporate the city of Miami. An early Miami pioneer named Isidore Cohen remarked that a darkie named Lightbourne gave the most compelling speech to incorporate the city of Miami. What was said in that speech, as noted by Isidore Cohen, by that darkie named Lightbourne, that was so compelling?
Gentlemen, we stand here on the precipice of a brand new day, as we, through our toil and efforts, will bring forth a brand new city, where every man will have a role to play in this new Jerusalem. But we must start by making our mark. When I first traversed these great lands of these United States some three decades ago, America was also on the dawn of a new day for all her citizens. Good Providence granted me the opportunity to teach newly freed citizens in our capital in Tallahassee. And good Providence granted me to serve as a sergeant of arms in our state legislative body. The esteemed Governor Reed also bestowed a great honor to me, and I also served as a justice of the peace in the great county of Gaston. Providence has been kind. Today, gentlemen, we stand once more on the dawn of a brand new day, where once more we can make our mark and be ingrained in the fabric of this brand new city and forever be ingrained in her foundation.
A proclamation was issued at Miami City Hall, presented in honor of one of Miami's forgotten founding fathers, Alexander C. Lightborn. Lightborn was instrumental in convincing the 163 black men needed to sign the charter that would incorporate Miami into a city. To accept the proclamation from the City of Miami Commission in her great-great-grandfather's name was Allison Lightborn Jones.
The City of Miami Distinguished Citizen presented to Alexander C. Lightborn. In recognition of his service, he was one of the 162 black men who signed the charter to incorporate the City of Miami in 1896. Bahamian-born Lightborn lived from 1850 to 1908. And is listed as an incorporator on the city charter. A railroad postal employee, Lightborn was a founding member of Bethel AME Church, served as Sergeant at Arms for the Florida House of Representatives, and was a teacher and justice of the peace. Thank you for your service. We know you're up there. In our community, to advance the quality of life and contribute to the City of Miami.
From what I understand with his personality, yes, he didn't want to be just seen, he wanted to be heard. And that type of dynamic is just, it's outstanding in that time period, you know.
Alexander C. Lightborn was also very active in local city affairs. He was the superintendent of the colored schools in Miami and was a founder of Bethel AME Church. In March of 1896, in Miami's historic Overtown District, even before his signing on the charter that would incorporate the City of Miami. In the church's inaugural service, celebrating 125 years of spiritual guidance in Overtown, Bethel AME Church celebrated its longevity in praise and song. This day, the congregants recognized the establishment of Bethel AME Church in Overtown.
"125 years ago, Greater Bethel was first established at the home of Alex Lightburn. 3 years later, Greater Bethel was established here where we all gather today. Greater Bethel has stood the test of time and we continue to stand strong and tall and proud. Again, welcome to our celebration, and thank you, thank you, thank you for joining us."
On this day, the church honored the legacy of Alexander C. Lightborn in the presence of his great-great-granddaughter, Allison.
"May I present to you Mrs. Allison Lightburn Jones, great-great-granddaughter of Alex C. Lightburn. Will you stand, please? Thank you.
My name is Allison Lightburn Jones. My great-great-grandfather is Alexander C. Lightburn. I did not know this when I moved from Harlem, New York to Miami in 2015. I was driving around feeling drawn to the city but did not understand why. In October 2019, my daughter sent me a text and said a woman was trying to reach me about my grandfather on my mother's side and to call her right away. She told me about A.C. Lightbourne and his important contributions to the city of Miami. At first I was shocked, but then it started to make sense to me. This feeling, this spirit that I could not explain why I was so drawn to Miami. My roots are here, my people were here. I longed for my mother, Catherine Lightbourne, but I know she is here with me today. I know her father, Arrington, the first black boy born in Miami, is here with me today. I know that his father, Alexander Jr., his mother, and his grandfather, Alexander Sr., is here with me today. I thank you today on behalf of all of them. Thank you. God bless.
On behalf of the members, our pastor and his family, and all the community of Overtown, we're grateful for what your great-great-great-grandfather planted in Overtown. Congratulations. We're happy to have you as a part of our membership. The Lord loves you, but we love you best.
If you're here today, come on
this day, a very special moment occurred. Allison joined the congregation and became a member of Bethel AME Church 125 years after being founded by her great-great-grandfather. The full circle of life came to fruition here at Bethel AME Church as founder Alexander C. Lightbourne's great-great-granddaughter Allison connected with her great-great-grandfather's stoic legacy.
A lot of African-American families need to really research their families. They need to research their heritage. So there's a lot of stories like myself that, you know, you do not know your great-great-grandparents or what they contribute to their surrounding neighborhoods or surrounding communities. But I'm glad that I know now. I'm glad that my daughter knows and that my daughter will carry on the legacy of my great-great-grandfather.
Here below. That means all of us, come on, praise him.
It's been a pleasure sharing the history with the voices from South Florida. I would like to take a moment to acknowledge in memory the contributions of Ava Parks McCabe, Charles Bethel, and Edwina Prime, all who played an instrumental part in helping us to do this documentary and work with us that have now passed on. Now the floor is open for questions from anyone.
Well, thank you for that amazing presentation. I just love hearing about all of the history you've uncovered and the connections you've made in this community. It's really just amazing. It always gives me goosebumps when I see those videos of Alexander C. Lightbourne's granddaughter, great-great-granddaughter, at the church that he helped to found. That's just amazing.
You all did a fine presentation, and we engulfed a lot of information. Thank you so much.
Very interesting things that I wasn't aware of, so it's very educational, and it should be something that should be presented in the schools.
I thought the presentation was awesome. It was dynamic. It definitely sparked the interest for me to do more research and to want to know more about how my people help this city become the great city that it is.
The presentation was fantastic, and I learned a lot today.
And I thought it was a wonderful educational accomplishment.
I think the presentation was actually phenomenal. This is something I've never expected.
It feels really good to know that, you know, being raised, born and raised in Miami, and it feels really good to know that, you know, we have a strong history here and a rich history that's being told and it's being researched, and we're being given the opportunity to learn these things. And
hi, my name is Catherine Labuda, and I'm the Special Collections Librarian here at Miami-Dade Public Library System. I just want to say this was an amazing presentation that really emphasized how important it is to research your local history, how you can use the library for so many resources, and I just want to say a big thank you because this was so special and really, really important, and I can't wait to see the final project.